In this video, I'll be talking about Orcus post YCS Dusseldorf, and by the end of the video, you'll find out if it really is the best deck. Before we get into this, if you guys are new here, my name is BladeYGO, and if you guys want more in-depth discussions on anything Yu-Gi-Oh related like this one, make sure you guys subscribe to my channel and turn on notifications to stay up to date to know when my videos come out. With that, let's get right into this. So to start, we need to address what I'm going to talk about. So to start, I'm going to talk about why the deck is good as of right now, the variety in which you can play the deck. So what I mean by that is, like, what are the different ways of playing the deck? Because honestly, right now there are quite an immense amount of ways of playing the deck. We are going to be talking about the future of the deck after even this format and after Dark Neostorm, for example, once we get the new Orcus cards after then, because then things get even more crazy for Orcus. And then lastly, I'm going to clarify and answer the question if Orcus is the best deck. So why is Orcus good? Well, to start, it's highly generic, and I think that's really the big appeal of this deck. So to start off, any two monsters with different names plus one card in hand equals the Orcus combo. And by Orcus combo, I'm referring to an Azathoth on the opponent's turn or an almost OTK. Basically, you're 300 life points off unless your opponent controls a monster for you to swing over with Borrowsword. There are definitely other ways of doing the combo as well, but those are just the basic two. So basically, the reason why it's such a good deck is because of how generic this is. Basically, any access to a Nightmare Cerberus or Phoenix means you can link that monster into a Nightmare Mermaid. Now, Nightmare Mermaid in this scenario is basically the equivalent of something like Spiral Double Helix or an Isolde. Basically, the reason why this is such a good package is because this provides quite an immense amount of power and quite a high ceiling to just two monsters and a discard. But the fact that it gives you the option of any two monsters really puts this package on a whole entirely different level. So maybe some examples of some really good cards to use is, for example, Neospace Connector. Now, obviously, Neospace Connector is primarily run in Warriors. However, at YCS Dusseldorf, Connector gained a massive popularity spike just because of its power that it presents to the table. And honestly, I will be having a video about Connector and why Connector is a problem. And so in the future, within this week, I'm pretty positive, expect a video on Neospace Connector. But with that out of the way, Neospace Connector is an amazing card for this combo, because not only does Neospace Connector force out any hand traps, for example, Ash Blossom or Drolan Lockbird, etc., but because Connector is basically a discard of anything, there's also the potential of hitting just a good monster out of your opponent's hand. There's as well the potential of Connector being able to snipe a hand trap, and then you go into Aqua Dolphin and everything, and then from there, because Connector is two bodies, that automatically is a one card combo with Nightmare Mermaid. So overall, Connector is honestly just a very solid card for the pure variant. We also have Phantom Skyblaster, which I feel as though no matter what variant of Orcus you are running, you are going to run Phantom Skyblaster, unless it's a non-pure focus variant, which we'll talk about those types of variants in a little bit. But Phantom Skyblaster is such an amazing card because not only can you normal summon it, get a token, and that's combo right there, but as well, you can also get additional value off of the Sky Blaster if you already have a pre-established monster. And so how do you get that pre-established monster? With the dangers. And that leads me on to talking about how this deck can abuse Bard and dangers more effectively than most, if not all, decks. So obviously, dangers are really poorly designed cards. So basically, the reason why dangers are so inherently dumb is because of the fact, again, they, as I've already stated in the past in other videos, that the dangers are inherently upstart goblins, but they also are free bodies on the field. But what's so crazy in the Orcus deck is you can get potentially additional value off of these discards. So for example, Orcus obviously activate in the graveyard, so that means if you're going to attempt to activate an Orcus effect, you can potentially discard an Orcus in order to use its effect in the graveyard from a danger effect, getting you just a massive amount of value off of that one discard. We can also talk about how dangers are just inherently, they keep helping you dig for more cards. But I think the reason why dangers are so much better in this deck than in other decks, like for example, Danger Thunder Dragon, honestly, in this deck, I would say dangers are far superior. Because if we look at a deck like Danger Thunder Dragon, usually you don't summon four danger monsters on the field. You usually have other monsters to back them up in order to make the initial Saryuja. Well, for a deck like Danger, all you need is two dangers, and those can be used as combo pieces in order to make your initial Orcus combo and get you access to the Nightmare package that gets you access to Orchestrated Nightmare. So the fact that you can use dangers as combo pieces instead of combo extenders, like how in the past we would instead see dangers be used as combo extenders. What I mean by that is combo extenders by they aren't used in the core combo, however they help you just keep pushing. But the fact that you can use dangers as combo pieces and combo extenders gives them a lot more versatility in what they do. Next, we also have to talk about the fact that this is a very scary combo deck that requires a lot less resources than a deck like Danger Thunder Dragon to initially go off. Think about it, Orcas only need two monsters and there are so many cards that get an additional body on the field, like again, Neospace Connector and Sky Blaster. But then from there, you not only are doing that, you discard one, which is totally fine, but then because it requires such a minimal amount of input compared to a deck like Danger Thunder Dragon, I feel that makes this deck much easier to be able to push through cards, and just overall, it's a much better and more effective deck at resource management. Now, depending on the variant, we also need to talk about bomb cards in the deck. For example, Phantasme, because in the going second variant, you can use Phantasme in order to go ahead and either use it as targeting protection or as an additional body for your Orcus plays, but then as well, you can also use it as just a hand fixer. We also have Danko, which obviously it's Danko, it's a very powerful card against back row decks and even Azathoth decks, so you can say that Danko kind of hard counters the going first Orcus variant, but then the going first Orcus variant also hard counters the going second variant in other ways. So we also have Distrudo, which gives you immense value because not only are you popping a card your opponent controls, but as well you're getting a Mare, which is not only an additional body, but as well can put out three more bodies along with that in order for you to go ahead and link climb into a Nightmare Mermaid play, which then again gets you into the Orcus package. That again is why Orcus are so scary, because of how generically easily able they are to be accessed and how many bomb cards you can play in order to access your Orcus, but in the process gaining so much value in the meantime. We also obviously have Connector and Sky Blaster, which again I've already mentioned a numerous amount of times by now, and honestly you can just run whatever you want in this deck. Again, we have cards like Trickstars, which Candina is a one card combo. We have the Sky Striker package, which you can just run three engage and one Hornet Drones. Even though some engages will be redundant, that doesn't matter if you just win outright because you summon an Azathoth. And also, that's a one card combo without even using your normal summon. Now, to be fair, one weakness this deck does have is it is fragile. So for example, an Ash Blossom and Joyous Spring on the Nightmare Mermaid can hurt. Ash on any Orcus in Grave, for example, Orcus Nightmare, and also the Orcus that special summons from deck can really hurt a lot. Also, DD Crow is another option for you to play against Orcus going second. So there are definitely ways of countering this deck, but overall, it's not really the greatest. I mean, sure, there are counters. Again, Ash on Mermaid and any Orcus. You can also Ash the Bard so they can't get the rank up spell. So in general, there's a lot of ways to stop the deck. But the fact that it's just so consistent and requires so minimal resources means typically they're able to push through a hand trap or two. And it's really good at doing so. We also can talk about the evolution of Danger Orcus, or just Orcus, and really how the deck is able to adapt its playstyle depending on what the player wants it to do. So for example, a go second variant that Antiception piloted at YCS Chicago could officially turbo out Borrelsword, and because it could officially turbo out Borrelsword so easily, that means that it could output quite a lot of damage. And so if you just had that generic, easily accessible Borrelsword single sword play that outputs 7,700 damage and all you needed was 300 more damage or another body on your opponent's field, that means that this deck can easily have a bunch more bomb cards in order to deal with the rest of the opponent's cards. We can also talk about how there are so many good going second cards as well, like I've already mentioned, Distrudo, Danko, Phantasme, etc. We do have the going first variant, which now Thomas Rose piloted to get first place at YCS Dusseldorf. And so now this is the latest evolution in the Orcus play. So basically, the idea now is to turbo out Azathoth on the opponent's turn. Basically, you go set up the rank up spell, set up Time Thief Redoer, all of those shenanigans. On your opponent's turn, you can flip the rank up spell, summon Azathoth. Sometimes you can also set up a Decode Talker with that play, making it an even better play. So just in general, the fact that you can go Azathoth on your opponent's turn, and Azathoth is a really scary card this format. I mean, a lot of decks can't handle it whatsoever. So the fact that you can just go Azathoth means that honestly, a lot of the time it could just be a blowout. And the last type of variants you can talk about are the non-pure variants. So the big one I'm going to talk about is Dark Warriors, except I'm not really going to talk about it in this video, but later this week or next week, I will be talking about Dark Warriors and what's going on with Dark Warriors right now. So if you haven't subscribed to the channel and want to see that discussion, go subscribe to the channel and I will see you soon with that discussion. But anyways, basically the idea of Dark Warrior, just a quick summary, is Dark Warriors have a higher going first ceiling. If you're already content with Azathoth, you can go with a more consistent variant, which would be the pure variant. However, Dark Warriors can also have the route of just going a pure warrior route instead of having to go through the Orcus route. Or if the warrior route is stopped, then they just go the Orcus route and then they're still fine regardless. So you can argue that the warrior variant can play through hand traps better. But at the same time, you can also argue that it's more inconsistent. So really, again, the variant you play is up to personal preference. Also, you have to run more cards in the Dark Warrior variant. You don't have to, but that's typically the standard. So honestly, up to personal preference what variant you play. But both variants are Orcus variants. And so what does the future of the deck entail? Well, first off, I feel as though this deck will be much more represented in the future. This deck was definitely underrepresented at this event, considering not enough people knew how good this deck was until Thomas Rose won, and now people start to understand that this is much better than people take it for. And so with that in mind, I can see Orcus getting more representation in the future. But then we need to also talk about post-Dark Neostorm, because after Dark Neostorm, the deck entirely changes with two new cards known as She Orchestrated Gearsu and Orchestrated Climax. Now, if you want my thoughts on those two cards, I will have a video in the top right corner in a card about the two new cards that I made a little while ago. But those two cards drastically shift Orcus and make the deck significantly better than it already is. So, is Orcus the best deck? Well, if we're determining Orcus being the best deck by representation, then honestly, I would have to say it's not the best deck in that front, because I still think that Salamon Great will still be the most represented deck 100%. I mean, considering the fact that Salamon Great took up 28 out of 64 slots in the top 64, just shows how represented the deck will be in the future. However, now that it's 1-0 YCS, I feel as though people will start paying attention to Orcus more and will take it more seriously in the future, and honestly, it might just catch on and surprise you as a top contender in the future.
Thank you guys so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed. If you want to support me further than just watching my YouTube videos, go down into the description and support me on Patreon. It helps out quite immensely. As well, if you guys want to talk to me further than just my YouTube comment section, go down into the description and join my Discord server. Thank you guys so much for watching, and with that, I hope to see you soon.